This is a live channels television event.
Your Excellency, Professor Yemi Osinbajo, GCONSAN, Vice President of the Federal Republic of Nigeria. Your Excellency, Engineer David Nweze Umahi, FNSCF Nathe, the Governor of Ebonyi State of Nigeria and Chairman of the Southeast Governors Forum. Your Excellency, the Deputy Governor of Ebonyi State, Barrister Eric Lechigwe, PhD, Honorable Minister of Finance here present, Zainab Ahmed, S. Ahmed, Honorable Minister of Senant for State, Prince Ekande Abba, here present, the Right Honorable Speaker of Ebonyi State House of Assembly, Chief Francis Obonanwifu, and distinguished members of the House, my Lord, the Chief Judge of Ebonyi State, Honorable Justice A.V. Singene, and his brother judges, His Excellency, the immediate past Governor of Ebonyi State, His Excellency, the immediate past Governor of Ebonyi State, Chief Martin N. Elechi, Federal and State Permanent Secretaries here present, Chief Stanley Okoro Emeya, Chairman of the APC Ebonyi State of Nigeria, members of Ebonyi State Executive Council, directors and participants of the summit, distinguished invited guests, members of the press, ladies and gentlemen. May I welcome you very specially to the National Council on Development Planning. Without further protocol, Your Excellencies, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, please let's welcome our dear Vice President with Kola Not. Biko Butenoje Kainabata, His Excellency.
Mr. Speaker, the Chief Judge, the father of our State Chief Martin Anelechi, and other leaders of the state. I don't know if Dr. Sam Ominyewu is here, he was with us, and Chief Francis Oji, former Deputy Governor of Odimi State, and our party chairman, and Secretary to Government, and all our leaders. Your Excellency, the tradition is that when we see a brother, a sister, a leader, a good visitor, we present Kola Not to say welcome. And when we do this in a traditional way, they say the Kola doesn't understand any other language than the language of the people. And so, sir, you are our brother, you are our friend, and you are our destiny helper. And that's why we traditionally present this Kola Not to you, sir. Your Excellency. Oji Aija Nabata, His Excellency, the Vice President of the Federal Republic of Nigeria. Your Excellency, Oji Abiawo.
Thank you very much.
I can buy it. You just pay me some money later. Okay, let me take it.
The Vice President in Abataroji, Anyimpere, Anyimpere, the Chairman of Saudi Traditional Rulers Council, Sir Ogo Ranyovoma. I don't know whether the chairman, Mone. The chairman, Ononebe. Okay. Udude, you know what else to do.
Is it? Ajadra, you go.
Chineke, I need kelelu. I kelelu baku berena. Ntanawa, Igoma Mele, Benue State, the President, Lachi Nigeria, President Muhammadu Buhari, Uyawono Chira Yabo Uche Piyala Kwa, Bo Professor Usibanjo, Uye Dara Boye Ntana, Oga Eleta Oroma, Governor Benue State, Chile Kene Anye, Tawadi Ahu Yuguwa Mwome Ndu Mera Anye, Yime Ahwe Sa, Ochi Ochi Sule Benue State, Tadba Pera Anye, Ulo Oro Di Chiche, Oro Le Benue State, Le Ogo Gono Le, Okwa Governor. Ale Kele Chileke, Gimere, Oka Madia, Bata Ebo Intan, Dia Hule Nya, Let of the Yule Kfu Lono Boy of Oyewe, Le Meleka La Hule Nya, Ala Adio Chileke, Ibe Gojia, Ebo State, Ibe Gojia Governor, Yele Ndi Yele Ala Che, Besko Chambers, Members, Mendo Okiwu, Mendo Leje Nzuko Assembly, Ebonyi State, Mendo Leje Nzuko Lagos, Abuja, Chileka Gojia President Ayibu Buhari, Lacha Ayin, Deme Igwe Dawa, Ruwa Ayin, Kanyi, Mende Ebonyi. Ayoke Shonyi Nkebo, Ebonyi Owa Dari Banyi, Tanibu Sibanjo. Ogojia Ayin Beda Mundeze, La Ayin Beda Bogrenya, Onde le leta ya le kweru kwere agoro kwa kwa ti gola agaru kwere le Nigeria ala ryo ime tande adari bayin we bi ala ntan te wela le fundi be wela ijoma to ba odu kula po pele chozo igo no ba ri oli imran sele Christ onye nwan.
Thank you very much, Your Excellency, dear Vice President. The summary is that God will bless you. Thank you. Biko Kenya, His Excellency, the Vice President Oji, His Excellency, our Governor, His Excellency, the Deputy Governor, Honorable Minister, the Speaker, my Lord, the Chief Judge, former Governor, the party hierarchy, members of the National Assembly, represented here by Comrade Chinedu Oga OON. Ikuku, you're welcome, sir. Thank you. Your Excellency, the Vice President of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, Professor Yemi Osibanjo SAN GCON, very distinguished ladies and gentlemen, once again, may I very humbly welcome you to the National Council on Development Planning. At this point, Your Excellency, it is my honor and privilege to very humbly invite for opening address the Honorable Minister of Finance, Budget and National Planning, Ahmed Zainab. Please, can we give him a round of applause as he steps forward to present his address. Honorable Minister, sir.
Your Excellency, the Vice President of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, the Executive Governor of Ebonyi State, the Honorable Minister of State, Budget and National Planning, Honorable Commissioners, Heads of Agencies, Resource Persons, Participants, Members of the Press, Distinguished Guests, Ladies and Gentlemen. I'm really delighted to be here today, even though virtually, to welcome you to the 21st meeting of the National Council on Development Planning, taking place in the ancient city of Abakaliki in Ebonyi State. This meeting, organized by the Ministry of Finance, Budget and National Planning, in close collaboration with the Ebonyi State Government, is a follow-up to the 2021 20th edition held in Maiduguri, Borno State. I would like to reiterate that the SCDP meeting is a meeting of states' honorable commissioners of budget and economic planning, organized annually as a veritable platform for senior officials of federal and state ministries, departments, and agencies representatives of the organized private sector, civil society organizations, and the academia, among others, to brainstorm on contemporary economic and social issues in order to propose workable solutions to the numerous challenges facing our economy. Let me begin by expressing my deep appreciation to His Excellency, the Vice President of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, Professor Yemi Osinbajo, GCON, for honoring our invitation to attend this event in person, despite his very busy engagements. This underscores the importance His Excellency attaches to the objectives and the direction of this meeting. I also want to appreciate His Excellency, the Executive Governor of Ebonyi State, Engineer Dave Umahi, FNSE, and indeed the good people of Ebonyi State for accepting to host this important meeting. The warm reception and hospitality extended to us so far has proven that the choice of Ebonyi for this meeting is certainly the right one. The timing of this meeting is noteworthy as its outcomes will influence national and subnational entities' 2023 budget formulation and implementation. You will agree with me that the only solution to our numerous challenges are to strengthen our institutions over and above personalities and deliver good governance to our people. As you are aware, the theme of this year's meeting, which is Good Governance and Institutional Capacity, Pathways to Sustainable National Development, has been carefully crafted to reflect the essence of good governance in providing the dividends of democracy to our people, as well as to improve the standard of living. The implementation of the Medium-Term National Development Plan 2021 to 2025 has entered the second year, with policies, programs, and projects of ministries, departments, and agencies derived from the plan. The vision of the plan is to unlock the full potential of public-private partnership and social sectors and enhance industrialization, sustainably improving Nigeria's inclusive but holistic development competitiveness. Overall targets are to achieve 5% growth on average and increase employment generation of about 25 million jobs by the year 2025. The total size of the investment is 348 trillion, out of which about 14% will come from government, while the private sector will contribute 85%. I therefore wish to state that as policy experts, planners, and managers of our economy, we must know that Nigerians are not interested on how we get it done or who should be blamed for our national predicaments. What they are yearning for is how the government intends to address the identified challenges, deliver good governance and dividends of democracy to the common man for sustainable national development. To achieve this and more, government has come up with various initiative programs and programs such as the National Social Investment Program, including the NPower, the Government Enterprise Program, the Conditional Cash Transfer, as well as the Homegrown School Feeding Program. We also have the Anchor Brewers Program, the Presidential Power Initiative, and the Presidential Fertilizer Initiative. The program of the World Bank, the 750 million support, is to cater for the poor and the vulnerable, providing immediate emergency relief to smallholder farmers as well as MSMEs. The World Bank loan over a two-year period has an intervention allocated to each state of $20 million US and $50 million US to the FCT under the NCARES. Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, you will agree with me that the cheering news to many Nigerians is not just about plan and well-articulated strategies and targets. It's rather about the consistency of this administration in the execution of programs and projects initiated even by past administrations to ensure that implementation benefits the citizens of our country. To this end, it is pertinent to note that the federal government is enjoining all states to align their state's medium-term plan to the national aspirations and work collaboratively with the private sector as much is expected from them in terms of investments. Before I conclude, Let me state that we need to be more conscious and committed to our responsibilities as leaders, such that the gap between the leaders and the led are narrowed or even closed. My call is that for all Nigerian politicians and religious organizations and all groups to join hands together so that we can work together as one. We must also shun negativities and focus on how best we can contribute to creating a new Nigeria where every citizen will have equal opportunities as well as realize their full potentials. On this note, I want to once again thank His Excellency, the Vice President of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, for attending this event. I also express my profound appreciation to the Ebonyi State people and government under the dynamic leadership of Engineer Dave Umahi. I commend the excellent arrangements and logistics that have been put in place for the success of this meeting. I also acknowledge the contributions of all participating organized private sector, and also everybody that has contributed to the success of this event. Finally, it is my pleasure and honor once again to formally welcome you all to the 2022-21st edition of the National Council on Development Plan meeting. Thank you very much for your kind attention. Good morning.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Honorable Minister. Your Excellency, very distinguished ladies and gentlemen. Next on the item is going to be presentation on the modest achievements of a great man, a great leader, and son of Ebonyi State, our dear Governor Engineer David Nweze Umahi, and it is powered by the Ministry of Information and State Orientation. I'd like to very humbly request the Honorable Commissioner for Information to please go ahead. Thank you.
Watching Channels Television, his live coverage of the 21st edition of the Joint Planning Board, JPB, and National Council on Development Planning meeting, which is holding in Ebonyi State. Present in Ebonyi State is Vice President Osinbajo, who is there to inaugurate some completed projects executed by the Governor, David Umahi-led administration. You're watching live coverage of the National Council on Development Planning meeting where the Vice President, Professor Yemi Osinbajo, is in Abakaliki to complete some projects which you're seeing at the moment now, which includes roads and infrastructure, executed by Governor Dave Umahi. Vice President Osinbajo arrived in the Exco Chambers in company of the Ebonyi State Governor a little earlier. The Minister of Budget and Finance and National Planning, Zainab Ahmed, earlier gave a speech to mark off, to sign off the beginning of the ceremony. And earlier as well, Governor Umahi performed the traditional handing over of kola to the Vice President. The Minister for Finance, Budget and National Planning, Zainab Ahmed, has delivered her address. And right now we're looking at some of those projects which are to be inaugurated by the Vice President.
Thank you very much, Honorable Commissioner. For information and state orientation, please can we give a round of applause to His Excellency the Governor for that giant stride.
You're watching the 21st edition of the National Council on Development Planning in Ebonyi State, where the Vice President and the Governor of the state is there for the inauguration of some completed projects.
And I would like to, with all respect, invite Ebonyi State Council for Arts and Culture, the UNU Group. So please come forward and use a few minutes to entertain us, please. Council for Arts and Culture. Thank you. Please, cameraman, can you adjust from the stage so that we can take the cultural dance, please? Thank you. Please come down and use your zoom lens, please. Please, you have 3 minutes and your time starts immediately. Let's go, please. with phenomenal achievements, a goal-getter, a development expert, His Excellency, Engineer Dr. David Nweze Umahi, Governor of Ebonyi State of Nigeria. Your Excellency, sir.
Vice President of the Federal Republic of Nigeria. Your Excellency, you're very much welcome. There is this excellency that we always feel about each time in the United States. Somebody asked me, what is ecstasy? Ecstasy,
you're watching Channels Television's live coverage of the 21st edition of the National Council on Development Planning. Currently speaking at the podium is Governor David Umahi, who is there to give a scorecard, as it were, of the developmental projects of his administration, for which reason some projects will be inaugurated by the Vice President, who is also present at the meeting. The Governor of Ebonyi State, Governor David Umahi, is currently at the podium making a speech with the presence of the Vice President, Yemi Osinbajo, there. Earlier, Minister for Finance and Budget and National Planning, Zainab Ahmed, had delivered her address, which centered on the programs of the federal government to boost the economy and living conditions of the people of Ebonyi State and the country in general, including NPower, the Anchor Borrowers Program. Also speaking earlier was the also lined up to speak rather earlier was the Commissioner for Information, Uchenna Oji. And also earlier we saw the Council for Arts and Culture in a state troop presentation.
In Nigeria, we shouldn't be. You know, love for the country and patriotism should be our driving force to move this country forward, because where there is no country, there are no leaders. But where we have a country, by decades of sacrifices, we definitely, we have a nation. So I have faith in this country, I have faith in our leaders, and I commend Mr. President and the Vice President and all the leaders. They inherited quite a huge, what the ordinary mind would say, insurmountable problem. But I think because God brought them, they have done quite a lot. And I challenge the party to broadcast the good and great things Mr. President and the Vice President are doing for our nation. They have really sacrificed. And this is one thing nobody can take away from them. Before I read this short address, let me say one or two things about, you know, setting, you know, issues of our national, you know, focus. You know, I feel so sad when there is a debate about VAT. All over the nation of this world, VAT is collected by the central government. And I don't know why everything in this country is politicized. If you say that the local government is a third tier of government, which means that they are empowered by law to collect VAT, going by the argument going on, then the state will collect VAT, then the federal government. So if goods are produced in one particular local government, and then they have to now get to the state, so local government will collect VAT, state will collect VAT, and if we move down to Enugu, there will be another set of VAT collection. It gets down to Kogi and so on and so forth. So it's an invitation to anarchy. We've been to other countries, and you find out that VAT in particular is different from state tax, you know, is being centrally collected. So are we encouraged, you know, the lawmakers to revisit this issue so that VAT will definitely go into the exclusive list. And I was told, of course, I read Mr. President, what he said, the Financial Act of 2010, you know, made it mandatory that the federal government will collect VAT. So I encourage this. And even some of the states that are not supporting this would be badly affected if this didn't happen. And let's not forget that the chain is as strong as the weakest link. And some of the developed states, you know, were developed in the past with the resources of the entire federation. Let's not forget that. So that some of us that are struggling out of our own sweat should be encouraged. The issue of subsidy or insubsidy is also another thing that calls for, you know, collective patriotism, because it is biting everybody. And I want to commend the Committee of Governors working with His Excellency, the Vice President. And I think that what he beautifully put forward, you know, which is to put the palliatives ahead of any kind of discussion or removal, like he proposed in our committee the issue of, you know, developing gas, you know, vehicles, converting some of our filling stations to gas stations, and of course on palliatives. I believe that the committee will have to revisit that so that we can reduce this madness that is called subsidy, which seems to be a monster, and which the nation Nigeria, not through politics, but through patriotism and commitment, you know, for the future of our children should honestly address. And so I'm pleased to welcome the Vice President of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, Professor Yemi Osinbajo, a dear friend of our state. Let me also welcome the Honorable Minister, the Minister that spoke to us, Mrs. Zainab Ahmed. She has been of great help to this state. Each time I needed to collect something, and provided it is due to her, she has always helped us so much. And of course, our old friend, Minister of State, you know, for finance, and the PAM secretary. We're glad to have you claim, and your PAM secretary. Thank you very much for coming. Today, indeed, it's a remarkable day as we mark the end of our hosting of the 21st edition of the JPB and NCDP meetings. As a state, we are delighted and privileged to host this event. Over the years, the JDP and NCDP has been a veritable platform for discussing very important and pressing economic issues of our dear nation. This goes a long way to the significance of this event, you know, today, that is termed good governance and institutionalization capacity, pathways to sustainable national development. I have no doubt that the outcome of this discussion would impact on the nation positively. As a state, our administration has worked tirelessly to curate various pathways for good governance, while also making notable efforts in socializing best and award practices. Let me say, without blowing our trumpet, that we came first, since we are talking finance here, in financial prudence and infrastructure sustainability, and so many other, you know, competitive indices, you know, you know, from the Ministry of Finance and, of course, also the Bureau of Statistics. This we did, as I was telling Mr. President, that before now we were being looked down upon, and I'm happy that the former governors fought the same battle. You know, each time, you know, a boy state is not that much regarded. And so the only way to do is to do mega projects so that those who were talking down on us, we have to have a rethink. And today, the story is different. So with your presence here, we intend to take you through a list of some of our modest achievements that has improved our state economy and also given a rating boost to a boy state in terms of physical discipline, IGA sustainability, improved debt management, in addition to significant growth in infrastructure and human capital development. Let me mention, sir, that people may be wondering our modest achievement, which I call miraculous, you know, achievements, and they think we are borrowing money from the bank. No, we remain the second least indebted state all over the Federation. That's after Jigawa, because I hate borrowing, and so we have been managing the little resources we have by engaging more in direct labor work. By so doing, we made sure that we don't have capital flight, and we are developing, you know, our people, that in every local government you go, you see that our people are, you know, engaged, and that's why the rate of unemployment here from this Bureau of Statistics is still as low as you know, the second again in the whole Federation. And so we believe strongly that through this direct labor and of course cement concrete technology, we are developing our people and then building our infrastructure to last for the next, you know, 50 to 100 years. And when people talk about maintenance, we are also enacting a law that we ensure that we give out a number of these mega projects to utility managers, so that over the years they will contend with maintenance of this infrastructure to ensure its continuity. If you're clapping for Ross delegates, you have to clap very well, because I think we made it. And when you go to FAC allocation, you can you know, move certain motions to help us to arrive. You can see we are on a journey. And I'm happy that the PAM secretary is listening very well. We need this money. We invite you all to consider investing in any of our various business-friendly projects and programs, such as the mall. You see a world-class mall this evening, which is a microcosm of the Dubai Mall. And then the world-class international market, the industrial cluster, the extraordinary King David University of Medical Sciences, and much more and much more. While you journey back to your various destinations at the end of this program, I wish you all safe journey. Lastly, you are invited to the gala night being organized by the Ebonyi State Government at the Ecumenical Center immediately after its commissioning.
by dear Vice President. Let me also note that immediately the Vice President finished the flag off and his speech, some very few dignitaries were accompanying the Vice President to commission the Government House, chapel. And after that, we also accompanied Mr. Vice President to commission the Dr. Sam Ominyewu flyover and a couple of other routes and inspect the international market. Thank you and God bless you.
Excellency Deputy Governor of Ebonyi State, Barrister Eric Kelechi Igwe, Honourable Member representing Eza South Equal Federal Constituency, the Honourable Chinedu Oga, and other members of the National Assembly present, the Honourable Minister of State for Budget and National Planning, Prince Clem Agba, Special Advisor to the President on Economic Matters, Ambassador Dr. Yemi Dipeolu, the Speaker of the House of Assembly, Ebonyi State, the Right Honorable Francis Obonaya Nwifuru, and other members of the State House of Assembly present, the Chief Judge of Ebonyi State, the Honorable Justice Elvin Ingene, Excellency the former Governor of Ebonyi State, Chief Martin Elechi, Professor Chigwe Ogwu, former Deputy Governor and now VC of the Ebonyi State University, heads of federal government agencies and parastatals present, members of the Ebonyi State Executive Council, honorable commissioners and representatives of all participating states at this National Council, the State Chairman, All Progressive Congress, Chief Stanley Okoro Emeha, elders, founding fathers of Ebonyi State, honored guests, ladies and gentlemen. And let me first congratulate His Excellency the Governor of Ebonyi State on this very well-appointed Executive Council Chambers. It is possible that His Excellency the Governor is not aware of the law that says that you cannot build an Executive Council chambers bigger than the one in the villa. Since he may not be aware of that law, we might excuse him, but I was considering asking His Excellency the President to issue an executive order to convert this one also to one for the use of the Federal Executive Council. Yeah. And there might be an advantage to that for the state, because we may come here more often. That is, the Federal Executive Council may meet here perhaps more often. I'm really delighted to be here at this 21st meeting of the National Council on Development Planning, holding here in Abakaliki, this beautiful and enchanting capital of Ebonyi State. I bring you the very warm greetings of His Excellency President Muhammadu Buhari, who, as you know, feels very strongly that national councils such as this have a very important role to play in boosting cooperation between the states and the federal government, as well as in helping better coordination of economic policies for poverty reduction and sustainable development. Permit me at this point to sincerely appreciate my dear brother, His Excellency Governor David Umahi, and the good people of Ebonyi State for the kind hospitality accorded to all the participants and their support towards the successful hosting of this meeting, and also for the very warm and affectionate welcome that I received from him, his family, and government and people of Ebonyi State every time I visit this state. I also commend the Honorable Minister of Finance, Budget and National Planning, the Honorable Minister of State for Budget and National Planning, as well as the Honorable Commissioners of Budget and National Planning who are here with us today, for their steadfastness in keeping the tradition of holding this council regularly and using it as an opportunity to exchange views on our national development trajectory. The Council on Development Planning has remained a very important platform for setting the tone of national economic discourse. It certainly provides a good opportunity for federal and state governments to somehow find active collaboration for the well-being of all our people. The need for synergy amongst all tiers of government remains paramount at this critical time, especially as we continue to face the challenges of recovery from the onslaught of the COVID-19 pandemic, which is now compounded by the ongoing war between Russia and Ukraine, the invasion of Ukraine. This war has already led to price and supply shocks, especially in food and fuel markets, and we must brace ourselves to collectively respond to the inevitable economic headwinds that will occur and some which are already occurring. But let me take this opportunity to congratulate the Council, the Federal Ministry of Finance, Budget and National Planning, federal and state MDAs, and all stakeholders, and indeed the private sector and civil society, for the stellar work that has been done in articulating our National Development Plan 2021 to 2025. The strategic objectives of the National Development Plan include establishing a strong foundation for a diversified economy, investing in critical infrastructure, enabling human capital development, and improving governance and strengthening security, all of which will certainly contribute to achieving our national development aspirations. The contents of the plan are as important as the process by which it was developed, and I find the extensive deliberations and contributions to fashioning our medium-term blueprint quite impressive and commendable. A lot of work was done in consulting practically all shades of opinion and all tiers of government and non-governmental organizations and groups. But the implementation of the plan is the crux of the matter. The implementation of the plan is the crux of the matter. And this speaks to the relevance of the theme of this meeting, good governance and institutional capacity, pathways to sustainable national development. A question that I am sure many of us ask ourselves, especially as planners, is why countries with huge natural and human resources, such as ours, still develop slowly, rate poorly on many human development indices, and have greater levels of poverty than other less endowed societies? Why, for example, do countries with no resources at all the likes of Japan, South Korea, Singapore, why do they still perform better than the resource-rich countries of the world? I think the sum and substance of most studies that have been conducted on this subject show that it is the lack of good governance and weak institutional capacity in the poorer and less performing economies that largely account for the difference between the poor and the rich countries. In other words, the way that public institutions and agencies perform public affairs and manage public resources, and also how they manage the participation of citizens and ensure equity and the rule of law, are what makes the difference between the poor and the rich, the performing and the non-performing economies. How public institutions function is of course likely determined by institutional capacity. And I think this is an important point. How public institutions function, how they deliver their services, is determined by institutional capacity. But this is not merely having a well-educated and well-motivated workforce, but systems that are and can enforce transparency and accountability. So it's not just about having an educated workforce or a well-motivated workforce. We must have systems that can deliver on transparency and deliver on accountability. So even where a country has all the natural resources in every local government and a reasonably well-educated workforce, willing and able foreign and local investors, the economy can still fail, social services can still be poorly delivered, and there may be no jobs, and extreme poverty can prevail. Why? Because if the system of collection of taxes, for example, is weak, and most people do not pay taxes, or the processes for getting government approvals of any kind is cumbersome, and if most public servants want to make money from bribes or thank yous received from those seeking government approvals, or investors find it difficult to get land approvals, building permits to build factories or plants, or the administration of justice system is so slow that plaintiffs can be thwarted just by delays, and law enforcement is weak or capricious and arbitrary. Where accountability is weak or non-existent, and poor performance or misconduct has no real consequences, then poor performance becomes systemic. So the result of poor governance is that the delivery of public goods is ineffective. Every public service is affected, whether it is in collection of taxes, as we said, or delivery of social programs, or public education, or health services, obtaining trade facilitation approvals, or even just obtaining passports or driver's licenses, or any kind of forbearance from the state, or the running of power services, whatever. Poor governance and institutional capacity mean a weak economy. And that is so for states, it's so for local governments, it's so for all governments. The private sector will perform suboptimally because the business environment is hostile, so fewer jobs are created. Housing stock may fall where private people do not want to build houses for rent, when tenants, for example, fail to pay their rent so they can remain in accommodation for years without paying rent. We had a problem while I worked in Lagos as Attorney General where we noticed that the housing stock fell. In other words, people were building fewer houses and they were preferring to invest in stocks and shares instead of building houses. We tried to investigate what was going on, and we found that generally speaking, people were considering building middle-income accommodation a poor investment. And the reason is because after they build the houses for rent, and the tenant pays for 2 years, thereafter, no further payments are made, the tenant goes to court, and the landlord and tenant are stuck in court for years, so the investment is essentially idle as far as the landlord is concerned. So people, rather than build low middle-income houses, would rather go and invest their money in stocks or shares. So wherever you have the failure of governance, such as the failure in this case, in the case in question, of the administration of justice system, it has a direct impact on the economy. If people cannot trust the administration of justice system, if they cannot trust the adjudicatory system, then it has an impact on the economy. So we had to work hard on our justice system in Lagos to remove those delays. We set up what was called the citizens' mediation centers to take rent disputes out of the magistrate court system and to have them mediated so that they could be done faster. So the truth of the matter is that every time that you have these problems, we must recognize that they are human problems. These problems are human. Problems of governance, problems of institutional capacity are human problems. They can be solved by human beings. Every country that chooses to solve its governance and institutional problems has, in effect, chosen to develop and prosper. And that goes for every state, every local government, every type of community. Once you choose to solve governance and institutional problems, you've chosen the path of development and the path of prosperity. But anywhere where dishonesty, lack of transparency, bureaucratic corruption becomes the norm, then such a society chooses backwardness and the poverty of the majority of its citizens. And I think that the most effective use of this meeting, there is still room for that, will be to find some answers. And I really strongly believe that even at our state deliberations and our national planning deliberations at the state level, we should be finding answers to this elephant in the room. How do we improve governance and institutional capacity? How do we improve governance and institutional capacity? We have the policies, we have the plans, but the weakness is implementation. The weakness is governance. The weakness is institutional capacity. And I hope that this may form, you know, the substance of some of our subsequent discussions, whether here or perhaps, you know, at the various levels of interaction at the state level. I'd like to thank you very much for listening and also to wish you very good deliberations as you go forward with this meeting. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Your Excellency. Please, a better round of applause for the Vice President of the Federal Republic of Nigeria. Thank you very much, Your Excellency. Very distinguished ladies and gentlemen, immediately after this event, there will be a group photograph with Their Excellencies right here. And of course, at 7 o'clock this evening, we shall be having a state banquet in the honor of the Vice President and his team. At this point, venue of the banquet is State Ecumenical Center, Abakaliki. Thank you very much.
As a link to several locations, businesses, and states. It is just one of the hundreds of multi-billion naira infrastructure spread across all parts of Ebonyi State. His Excellency, Governor David Umahi's giant strides in all sectors of development in Ebonyi State fulfills the popular saying that when a good leader is on the throne, the people rejoice. For the first time in all of its history, Ebonyi State has a clear-cut industrial policy, thanks to the foresight of Governor David Umahi. It is to his credit that the governor created huge industrial clusters in the three senatorial zones of the state. They are located strategically with proximity to raw materials and markets. The clusters have the capacity to create over 200,000 jobs for Ebonyi people and others, as well as reduce the brain drain the state has suffered over the time. From 2015, when Governor David Umahi came into office, Ebonyi State has witnessed an unprecedented infrastructure revolution, both in terms of number, quality, and relevance to the lives of the citizens. This is the multi-billionaire ultra-modern Ebonyi State Ecumenical Center, a magnificent piece of architecture. The 10,000 capacity Ecumenical Center is built with the finest materials: gold, silver, bronze, copper, aluminium, and everything that makes a temple of God befitting for worship. Governor David Umahi believes the Ecumenical Center is the altar of God where people in the state can make supplications.
It is the love of God and the love for people that has brought all this development that we see.
You're watching Channels Television. You're watching Channels Television and the 21st edition of the National Council on Development Planning Meeting, which is holding in Abakaliki, Ebonyi State, for which purpose the Vice President, Professor Yemi Osinbajo, is present. Right now, the phase they're in is for the commissioning of certain projects of the Dave Umahi administration, one of which is the Government House Chapel. And right now, the Vice President is commissioning the Government House Chapel.
Once again, good afternoon, His Excellency, the Vice President of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, Professor Yemi Osinbajo. I'd like to specially welcome you to Ebonyi State, the South of the nation. And I know that your coming here today has brought so much grace and peace. Thank you so very much. We are right in front of the Government House Chapel, the new one that is really built by our governor, our wonderful, hardworking Governor, His Excellency, the King David Osinbajo. Thank you so very much. We welcome you especially for this official commissioning of this prestigious edifice built in the honor of God and for the service of humanity. Thank you so very much, sir.
Thank you very much.
The Vice President, Professor Yemi Osinbajo, has officially commissioned the Government House Chapel in Abakaliki, Ebonyi State, alongside the Governor, Dave Omahi. The Vice President is in the state for the commissioning of a number of projects across the state, and all on the 21st edition of the National Council on Development Planning. The Vice President is also expected to commission other projects on this day. Earlier, taking to the podium, he spoke about issues of national development and the impact of the Umahi administration. And also earlier, the Minister for Finance and Budget and National Planning, Zainab Ahmed, delivered her speech, which centered on the programs of the federal government. As they make their way now through the just commissioned Government House Chapel, it's expected they will visit other areas in Abakaliki to make sure the other projects are commissioned as well. All this is happening to mark the 21st edition, the closure of it, of the National Council on Development Planning. Dignitaries and personalities from the public and private sector in Ebonyi State are present on this occasion. Now we're going to be showing you some of those projects to be commissioned by the Vice President on this day, the developmental projects of the David Umahi administration in Ebonyi State.
Welcome to the new Abakaliki, one of the most beautiful capital cities, not just in Nigeria, but in Africa. Strategically located in this city is a piece of critical infrastructure that has changed the face of Ebonyi State, placing it firmly on the global map. The President Muhammadu Buhari four-way light tunnel, a beauty to behold during the day and a sparkling eye-catcher at night. Initiated and completed by the Umahi administration, the tunnel serves as a link to several locations, businesses and states. It is just one of the hundreds of multi-billion naira infrastructure spread across all parts of Ebonyi State. His Excellency, Governor David Umahi's giant strides in all sectors of development in Ebonyi State fulfills the popular saying that when a good leader is on the throne, the people rejoice. For the first time in all of its history, Ebonyi State has a clear-cut industrial policy, thanks to the foresight of Governor David Umahi. It is to his credit that the governor created huge industrial clusters in the three senatorial zones of the state. They are located strategically with proximity to raw materials and markets. The clusters have the capacity to create over 200,000 jobs for Ebonyi people and others, as well as reduce the brain drain the state has suffered over the time. From 2015, when Governor David Umahi came into office, Ebonyi State has witnessed an unprecedented infrastructure revolution, both in terms of number, quality, and relevance to the lives of the citizens. This is the multi-billion naira ultra-modern Ebonyi State Ecumenical Center, a magnificent piece of architecture. The 10,000 capacity Ecumenical Center is built with the finest materials: gold, silver, bronze, copper, aluminium, and everything that makes the Temple of God befitting for worship. Governor David Umahi believes the Ecumenical Center is the altar of God where people in the state can make supplications.
It is the love of God and the love for people. Thank you.
The building of Church Avenue in Ebonyi State by Governor David Umahi is a display of his love and commitment to God. The Church Avenue is not a new idea, but an existing place with a cluster of churches, with structures not befitting a house of God. Governor Umahi decided to personally give them a facelift. The Ebonyi Shopping Mall ranks amongst one of the top 10 shopping malls in Nigeria and West Africa.
Live coverage of the 21st edition of the National Council on Development Planning. We've been showing you some of the projects of the Dave Umahi administration, some of which will be commissioned by the Vice President, Professor Yemi Osinbajo, of which one has already been commissioned, which is the Government House Chapel in Abakaliki, the state capital. The 21st edition of the National Council on Development Planning has in attendance the Vice President, Professor Yemi Osinbajo, the Governor, Dave Umahi, dignitaries in the public and private sector of Ebonyi State, and the Minister for Finance, Budget and National Planning, who delivered a virtual contribution in her address, which centered on the progress of the federal government as far as the economy and living conditions of Nigerians is concerned, after which the Council for Arts and Culture engaged in a troupe performance to entertain the Exco Chamber, where the initial meeting took place. But what's happening now is the Vice President is making his rounds around Ebonyi State to commission other projects of the Dave Umahi administration. Governor Dave Umahi, taking the podium, spoke on federal issues, since the federal government was represented or is represented at this event by Vice President Yemi Osinbajo. And some of those issues include value-added tax collection, subsidy, and on the state level, he spoke on the projects his administration has undertaken for the development of the state economy. Shortly to see some of those other projects that the Vice President will be commissioning in his itinerary today. Earlier, as we were showing you live, his first port of call was the Government House Chapel in Ebonyi State, where the Vice President commissioned and commended the Governor of Ebonyi State for his prioritizing the matters of honoring God in issues of governance, for which that particular building was also, as a motive, was built, the Government House Chapel. He'll also be going on other projects, which we expect we'll be showing you in the course of this live coverage of the 21st edition of the National Council on Development Planning, taking place in Abakaliki, Ebonyi State. This is Channels Television. You've been watching the 21st edition of the National Council on Development Planning in Ebonyi State, Abakaliki. We'd like to return you now to our regular programming.
You've been watching a live Channels Television event.